welcome to ETCFO. This is Vartika, your host for today. To discuss what it actually means to be digitally transformed and how to get there and what is expected from the CFOs, we have with us two experts from Oracle. Please join me in welcoming Ajay Kumar, Head Solution Engineering Applications India, and Pradeep Agarwal, Senior Director, ERP Cloud. Hello, sir.
Hello, Vartika.
How far is Indian organizations from being digitally transformed or, you know, adopting those technologies?
I don't think the Indian organizations are far off at all. Every Indian organization has access to exactly the same level of information, the same level of technology that any organization, anyone, anywhere in the world has. There's absolutely no difference. It's just about people gearing up for change, picking up technologies that work for their organization, taking small bite-sized chunks, figuring out what matters the most for their organization, start trying out these technologies. In terms of availability of technology, in terms of the ability of the technology to work in a given environment, India is nowhere behind anyone else in the world.
Mostly in your recent report, which we were talking about, which is Agile Finance Unleashed.
Mm-hmm.
So there, you know, you're talking about digital transformation falling on finance function, you know, mm-hmm. finance function driving digital transformation in the organization. So in that context, you know, what constitutes a good finance team of a digitally transformed organization?
A good digital finance team of an organization is all about modern business practices.
Modern business
practices. It's all about business insights or data insights. Today, you should use data as a weapon, right? And third is about business influence, right? So any finance team which is able to focus on business and let technology be automated, for example, the daily routine task, the task that a finance and a CFO organization does, if that can be taken away from them and CFOs and the finance team can focus on business processes, on analytics out of the data that they have, on influencing the business the way the new process need to build, I think that's how a good digital transformation organization is all about.
You know, you're right. All the mundane work can be automated.
Absolutely.
And, you know, technology can manage that part. But there's a human intervention that comes in, you know, when we talk about skills and capabilities. So what are the tools and training that is needed to empower the finance team to make that better corporate decisions, you know?
So Vartika, one thing. First thing is that yes, human intervention is required. No one is saying that human intervention will go away. We are not talking about creating a matrix kind of world.
Yeah. Okay.
Though it will be very cool to live in, but we are not talking about creating that. Human intervention is required to manage exceptions. What a system has to do is run a process and keep on learning from mistakes. These mistakes will be corrected by a human hand. No debates about it. The decisions will be taken by human mind. Over a period of time, what the systems do is, through machine learning, through artificial intelligence, will keep on getting smarter and smarter and understand a human reaction to a given set of problems. And that is how, you know, systems can reach an ultimate optimum level of automation, if you will. And humans can be left just to do design thinking, just to take decisions, and to manage exceptions. That is the first part that you talked about. In terms of the skilling that is required, see, the skills are there in the market. You're not talking about skilling masses of people suddenly on a new technology, which sounds obviously very, very difficult task to achieve in a short frame of time. Skills are available. All that you need to look at is how to reconstitute a team that has those traditional skills, which are not going away. You know. How you deal with a banker is going to be a human skill. It's going to continue to be a human skill in a finance organization. How do you marry that with the skills available for, say, data visualizations, data science, understanding what processes are doing for your organization, setting those right? You just have to augment that. You don't have to necessarily reskill your people. You have to reskill your team, which is a process of acquisition of skills rather than training.
You know, just to add on to Ajay, you know, I keep saying this, Vartika, that finance and artificial intelligence or process automation is made in heaven. Mm-hmm. And the reason I say this is, you know, 70% of the tasks are almost automated. You know, there's something called a FAQ, right?
Yeah.
Frequently asked questions. So, you know, if you were to call up a call center, Then about 70% of the questions are questions which are repeated by customers over and over again, right? And when you call up the call center, you most likely get an automated response, right? Same thing happens with the finance function as well. There are 70% of the tasks which are automated, right? So what you just need to do is identify those patterns, automate those processes, and let technology handle that. And rest of 30%, you can work, you can apply your mind, you can do some innovation around it, you can make changes to the work environment, to the business processes, which ultimately helps the business. So that's what tools and skills are all about.
My question is, who are digital finance leaders? Who will you call digital finance leaders?
Well, if you're looking at by way of examples, organizations, there are many, many examples within the Indian diaspora. The many organizations that do continue to work traditionally, but also have transformed their business digitally. Take Paytm, for example, okay? Or take Myntra, for example. These are the kinds of organizations, retailers or e-tailers rather, like Myntra. They do have the traditional finance function, which is required for reporting compliance and so on and so forth, but they also have finance functions that very specifically focus on the daily billions of transactions of data that comes in. That their job is just to analyze that, to draw patterns out of it, and to figure out how this pattern can be used for the business. So there are many examples in the country.
Coming back to the report, so in your report, it says that the revenue growth over last 12 months, close to half of digital finance leaders, which is 46% of the finance leaders, said that their organization has achieved positive growth in revenue. And this drops to less than a third, which is 29% for non-leaders. So, Mr. Kumar, just tell me one more thing, that how does digitalization falls on finance function? Is it the change in finance function that has this revenue change, the number change?
Well, the cause effect or the effect cause can always be debated, that you know, organizations with higher revenue are investing more, mm-hmm. or organizations that are investing are getting better revenues. Mm-hmm. That can always be debated, but look at it from this perspective, which is the only place in any organization, any large organization, where you have every bit of information available. It's the finance function. No matter what you're doing anywhere in the organization, no matter what the impact of any decision is that you take for any part of the business, ultimately that's get converted into a finance number that comes to the finance function. Right? It can be part of the planning process, it can be part of the accounting process, it can be part of the compliance process, or anything else. So finance function has always been in the best situation to leverage information across business function in any organization, and that convert that into meaningful insight for the organization to take decisions. And that is why we strongly feel that the digitalization transformation for most of the organization will fall on the finance function first, because they are the most geared up to do that. They have the most access to the data that can cause or that can help this transformation. And that is why probably finance teams across organizations seem to be leading that change. Of course, the change that they bring in will have an impact on the entire organization. It's not just the finance function changing, the surrounding function will also get transformed in the process.
You know, just to add on to Ajay, why finance function? It's actually an important question, and I think a question that requires a lot of consideration. See, what happens is, as I said in the beginning of my discussion, today what is the most important thing is speed and regulations, right? And the other important thing is business processes, right? Now, I may be repeating these words, but these words have very deep meaning. So let's look at an example of an organization which were to basically declare the financial results, right? And it takes 3-4 months for them to declare finance results. You know, so the CFO's office is busy, you know, collating data, analyzing data, and then maybe talking to the analyst and the market and so on and so forth, and this happens after 3 months. Assuming an organization which is able to consolidate, analyze, and declare results and talk to the analyst in 2 or 3 days flat. Look at the amount of time, look at the amount of effort, look at the amount of revenue generation activities an organization can focus on. And that's why a finance function is so important, and it has a direct impact on the organization's both top line and bottom line as well.
You know, digital finance leaders are in minority. Mm. And as quoted in the report itself, according to McKinsey, CFOs generally attribute slow progress in automation due to lack of understanding of all the digitalization opportunities available. So organizational silos and lack of digital skill sets within the finance function are also commonly cited as major impediments. So then how are the CFOs expected to keep up in this changing environment? And it is a big change, digital transformation. And how then are CFOs expected to gear up, and how should they gear up?
See, when we talk about lack of understanding of digitalization opportunities, right? I think what we are mistaking this is for understanding the tools that are available for digitalization. Okay. A hardcore finance professional, yes, I do not expect him or her to actually figure out suddenly how a blockchain works. You may have an idea at a high level, but not the nuts and bolts. In my view, a finance leader should not even be looking at that. What you do is, you try to envision your organization of the future. You don't say my future organization would be using artificial intelligence or blockchain. As a finance leader, say my future organization will make sense of all the sales data across geographies, across business functions, across the products that I have, and will draw pattern analysis on an hourly basis. Now, this is something that as a CFO you can visualize. You don't need to understand what technology will come in. Then people like us will bring the technology to do that, because technology is available in the market. The problem is people start trying to figure out how will a technology benefit my organization before they figure out what their future organization is going to look like. Focus on your business process. Focus on your business outcomes. There is enough tool, enough technology in the market to back up your vision, right? So for example, what I talked about, a CFO says that, hey, I need to do this pattern analysis. Give us that problem. We can bring in artificial intelligence, right? Working with the entire data model within your organization, and no matter what the data model is, no matter what the data set is, we can make sense out of any kind of data. We take that data, we start projecting results, and what you do as then as a finance leader is start correcting it. The first time results probably may not be as good as you want it to be. Then you start training the system by telling, hey, this is what additionally can be done. You talk the language of the finance leader. The system will translate that into whatever coding required and will then churn out the data and give you the information. So the digitalization opportunities should not be looked at in terms of identifying what technology to use. Finance leader, business leader should focus on the business. That is the fundamental principle of bringing this digital revolution.
You know, just to add on to Ajay, and this is a most commonly used word when I am talking to a lot of CFOs and business leaders, is about consumerization of IT, right? So today what is happening is IT adoption in daily lives is far simpler, far easier, and far more accessible than IT within the organization. But there's no difference. The way you use and access technology at home, similarly you would want to use technology in the business, right? So I simply don't understand in terms of why does it become complex for technology adoption in businesses when you're doing the same thing at home. It's just that at home you may be using some social media tools, but in business you're using similar technologies. You've got a similar screen, you've got a similar user interface, you've got a similar maybe drag and drop and accessibility of the information. Even in business you can access application on mobile, you can access the information anywhere, anytime, any place. So there's no difference between either using technology at home or in business, and the way consumers are adopting technology, similarly businesses need to adopt technology. And it's just about using it, making sense of the technology that is being deployed in the organization, and accessing the information and helping it run the business.
I think agility comes when you go absolutely. And move forward, you make mistakes, you
absolutely.
You have to make a start somewhere. Yeah. We have seen all these Alexa ads, right? Play this song, play that song. Hey. The same Alexa can also respond to your questions on your financial results. That Alexa is hooked on to your internet and to your choice of songs, the same Alexa can be hooked on to your database and can start giving you finance results. It's just a question of how comfortable you are using the same technology that you're using at home, as Pradeep said, in your work life also.
One more example of this is, you know, the whole cryptocurrency, which is a blockchain technology, right? Yeah. So popular, it's become so viral, you know, a lot of people have made a lot of money and also lost money. But they're using it, right? They don't know the technology behind cryptocurrency is blockchain, right? So it is being used. Nobody taught them. Yeah. Nobody asked, you know, Pradeep or Vartika in terms of how do you trade in cryptocurrency, right? Mm-hmm. So same thing goes with business. You have an underlying technology, which could be blockchain or artificial intelligence or machine learning enabled, and you're just using it for business. That's how it works.
All right, my last question to you guys is that, you know, for those who are aware and working towards making that shift, making this shift, investment decision becomes very critical, and especially for CFOs. But with uncertain returns and results of using that technology, how are CFOs expected to take that leap when investment decisions makes or shapes the future success of the business? And on what basis should they take this decision?
Investment decisions is absolutely. See, look at what technology is doing today. And it's important to go into a bit of history for a few seconds only. If you look at the traditional technology that was prevalent in the market, say about 4 or 5 years back, the technology was always designed to grow bigger. That is how we were designing technology, because scaling up has always been the question. The first thing that these new set of technologies, whether you call it artificial intelligence or say robotic process automations, blockchains and so on and so forth, the first thing that these technologies very rightly have tried doing is look at the option of scaling down, which means a lot of these technologies can be consumed in smaller chunks. The investment decisions that we are talking about can be way smaller, way easier as compared to the traditional IT. Because you can take a very small risk, get a taste of the automation that you want to do in your organization, right? Get some results, move on to the next one. That is one way of looking at it. The other thing is, unlike traditional IT, where failure, if it had to happen, would come in 10 years, right? Here you can try, probably invest a few $1,000, get the results in a few weeks, decide whether it works for your organization or not, and move on to the next one. Okay, so these investment decisions become fairly simpler with the new technologies that are coming up. In fact, I want to point out three things that these new technologies are doing very critically. The first one is these technologies are economizers, if you will.
Economizers.
Yeah. Because these technologies, as I said, with the inherent ability to scale down and scale up at whatever level you want, these technologies can be tried and tested at a very, very low cost of entry. Right? So there's a certain level of economy that comes in. The second thing that all these technologies are doing is, these are enablers. Okay? The way these enable is, you're rolling out a technology and immediately you can see the impact or effect of the technology on the business function where you tried the technology. You can see the data, you can analyze the data, you can see whether it works for your organization or not, and then move on. Right? So these are big enablers. The third thing that we have to keep in mind is these technologies are big equalizers. Because, as I said, of the inherent ability to scale down, it is not just that, you know, the top 10% businesses in a given country can use these new technologies. No, the smallest of the business can take it and get a taste of the technology, because these technologies can go down to any business level and can go up to any business level in any market, if you will. So investment decisions are now, with the new technologies, fairly simplified. What you have to identify is the priority, the business priority for your business. That's about it.
Yeah, Pradeep. Just to add on to Ajay, I think he summarized this very well in terms of equalizers, economizers and the adoption. You know, for me, fundamental difference between yesterday's technology and today's technology is the cost of adoption. it is not as if, you know, we are transforming the world and, you know, we have something completely different in technology today that we have. We have had technology for a long time. Again, companies like Oracle have been helping our customers for many years, many decades, right? But the question is, the technology that we had did a fantastic job yesterday. They can even do a job today. The question is, will it be able to do a job tomorrow? Now, when we are answering that question in terms of tomorrow's job today, then we need to give a way and a passage to the CFOs or leaders within an organization so that they can take a leap of faith, they can take risks without investing millions of dollars which they used to invest earlier, right? So you can start small. The whole, cost of adoption is going to be very low. You can try, you can fail fast. You can innovate on the processes and the technology that you have adopted. And if you find success, then you can expand, scale, and make sure the entire organization adopts it. So that's the biggest advantage today with regards to the cost of adoption.
Thank you so much for joining us here.
Thank you, Vartika.
Thank you for your time.